My father died a couple years ago, and he was a real character. He was almost like a hobo most of his life. He had a very tough life, just a wanderer. Sat in parks and never had anything. And I got in touch with him last, I didn't see him for 18 years, and, but I got in touch with him the last 10 years of my life, and I took care of him, more or less, and got to know him. He was a real kind of guy, you know. And I find, especially since he died, two jobs I've done, I have found myself using him, using his ways and his sounds and his movements a great deal. And when I started picking up the interviewer a couple of weeks ago, when as Twain, I do Twain putting on this, you know, act for the interviewer and pretending to be cuckoo or something. I'm thinking of my dad now, and I'm gonna have fun with that now, to characterize Twain's behavior with the interviewer in that style. It's gonna be fun. I like to talk to students very much. I like to find out what they're thinking, if I can. And it's a wonderful feeling to be able to directly express to them my feelings. I don't give speeches, and I've made a habit of being almost painfully honest and open about my feelings. When they ask me a question, I really tell them what I think, whether it sounds right or not. And also, I think in acting, when you're acting a role, that it's far more exciting to take this, to confront the role honestly and directly and play it for real, instead of making it into some kind of a, I don't know.
Idea,
yeah. It would be very hard for me now. I don't think it, I know it. It'd be very hard for me now to let a year go by where I didn't do Mark Twain, because this is my 31st consecutive year. Sometimes I've thought, you know, what if I had a couple of big jobs, a lot of money and everything, 1 year I didn't have to do Twain. I've already decided that I would go out and do him 3 or 4 times or something, just to keep it running, because, I mean, I'm on a big winning streak here. And I'm on a roll, you know, and I don't know how I got on this roll, and my luck has been phenomenal. I still find myself astonished at least, that so many people still keep coming to see it. But I think it would be very exciting to continue doing it until I dropped dead and couldn't do it any longer. And it's making its mark in theatrical history, of all things. I never would have dreamed when I started out doing this, and I never would have dreamed that might get in the theater history book someday. A college or something, just on the edge of Little Rock. It was right after the riots at Central High School. And I had this lynching number from Huckleberry, and I was, pretty much shocked by what was going on. I wasn't real involved in political thinking at the time, but I was moved by what had been going on there, very much so, and I decided I would do this number with an intent in my mind to make a comment upon violence, mob violence, as it relates to, and the transfer people make, even though this is a white man shot a white man, there's an obvious parallel there that Twain is making, especially in Colonel Sherburne's speech to the mob, where he tells them that they're cowards and the only way they ever come and lynch anybody is at night, and they bring their masks.
Well, the truth is
that no mob has any sand in it, in the presence of a man known to be splendidly brave. But where should such brave men be found? If physically brave men would do, why, that'd be easy. They could be had by the cargo. But morally brave men and women who can face up to church-going gangs of hooded murderers, don't seem to be very many morally brave people left in stock.
You see, a lot of people who read Huckleberry Finn read right through that speech without ever having a thought in their mind that he's talking about the Ku Klux Klan.
Now, when I talk about the decay in the art of lying, I'm talking about the silent lie. It requires no art. You simply keep still and conceal the truth. For example, it would not be possible for a humane and intelligent person to invent a rational excuse for slavery. And yet in those early days of the emancipation agitation in the North, those agitators got small help from anyone. Argue and plead and pray as they might, they could not break the universal stillness that reigned from pulpit and press all the way down to the bottom of society. The clammy stillness created and maintained by the lie of silent assertion. The silent assertion that there wasn't anything going on in which humane and intelligent people ought to be interested.
Suddenly, I realized I had some method of speaking, of saying things that I felt, of expressing my feelings about what was going on in the world. It never occurred to me. I thought, my gosh, there's material here. I can make statements, you know, through this guy, you know, which is safe because they like Mark Twain. I could get angry. And then I started working on material that, as this whole thing developed, civil rights revolution, and then the Vietnam War, which from the beginning I just felt was an awful, kind of strange, misbegotten adventure, I started developing material along both those themes. And by that time, I was hot, and I really knew that I had a hold of something that could go in many directions and became very exciting. In fact, it was. For some reason, I don't know, it seemed that right after some of the most dramatic and horrible things that happened in the South in the 60s, I'd have a date in the town or the next town. But I'd been through many situations like this several times, and even with Little Rock, I'd always been surprised at the response of the audiences in the South. It was like they wanted to say something and couldn't. But in responding to what I was bringing out, they were able to approve and express their feelings. And I gambled on that, and I picked my way through that program. My knees were shaking. And I just kept coming, and they kept coming, and by George, they were great. They had a phenomenal response. 200 people came backstage.
How would you characterize your personal relationship or feeling toward him?
Well, it's almost like he's become at least the Mark Twain that I envision, you know. Has become just integrated into my whole life and my feelings and everything. I don't think about it very much anymore. He's a great source of amusement for me, no matter what the subject, you know. He's always he's a tremendously amusing and wise old bird. And his thought processes are fascinating to me. I don't know how else to describe it. It's just a part of my life in many ways. You know, anyway you can think of, he's made, you know, made me famous and made people know my name, and then also I've done some service for him, and it's a step up from a lot of the other things I've done as an actor. I mean, both in excellence and also in the level of achievement, you know. And I get to express my feelings about the world and myself, my own feelings and everything, through him, very much so. A lot of them very personal. One time or another, something in the show will become intensely personal to me for some reason.
That's the thing I've noticed in your responses here today. You consistently, question after question, make a personal response rather than a conventional response.
Mm-hmm.
How come? How?
Well, I like to talk. I like to get my mind thinking, you know, and I don't know what other response you could really make except to avoid a question, which is not exciting. It's exciting to take on a question. Somebody asks you a question that may be a hot potato. It's much more fun to really give them an honest answer. Sometimes it shocks and surprises them, but that's fun. It's just like, it's far more exciting and more fun to do a movie on television, which reaches this great mass of people, to do a movie that is controversial, that is tough for a lot of the audience to handle, on a subject that really can get them nervous and angry, upset, irritated, whatever. Much more interesting to do that than just do some ordinary script some ordinary story.
Well, you've, in your career, you've gotten many of the special parts that maybe only Hal Holbrook could have done.
I've been very, very lucky about that.
And you basically feel fortunate about that.
Yeah, I wish, you know, there were more. I miss, you know, when I don't see something coming along where I can, well, they don't just happen that often, and it's great when you get a hold of something where you can really get your teeth into it and say something through your character.
Finally, I guess the character or the characteristics of your characters have been integrity. You really communicated, to me anyway, above all else, a sense of integrity. Has that been intentional or?
It isn't an intentional thing. I don't go about playing a part thinking about the integrity. I mean, even when I play villains, I don't know what kind of integrity they have, but I guess they have their own brand of it, like the guy in Magnum Force. But no, I don't set out looking for something like that. I just try to figure out what kind of a person that is and play him.
Good. Thanks a lot.